If you are watching this video from a smartphone or a tablet, you are not seeing the messages that are on the screen presently. These messages are important, and I would suggest that when you have the opportunity, please view this video from either a desktop or a laptop computer, because you cannot see the messages on the screen from your smartphone or your tablet. Thank you. Okay, this segment we're going to show you the disassembly of the shield. We're going to take the trigger assembly out, and we're going to take this sear assembly out. It's all very easy. It's nothing you need to worry about. You should have a few tools. Now I'm going to show you this. This is a punch set I purchased at, this is actually Harbor Freight. I've got another set here that I got from Sears, you know, but you're gonna need punch sets. This set was like, I think on sale, $7-$8, you know, it's 8 pieces in there. I'm using two of the eight, but if you're going to work on your guns, you should have some of the correct tools, and I would suggest you buying a punch set. You could work on it. You could take a nail and flatten it out and use a nail. It would work. Like I say, for $6-$7, you might as well start buying the tools that you're going to need. Eventually, you're going to need something like that. Anyhow, we've got the shield. My shield is safe. It's empty. Okay, nothing in it. We're gonna break it down now. We're gonna show you how to take everything apart on it. First of all, I'm gonna lock it open. We all know how to get it down to the clean section. Now, normally they'll tell you to go in and reach in and do the lever. Well, I don't ever do the lever. I just take it, click it, and off she comes. Okay, so now we've got strictly the lower component, and we've got the internal parts on there. Okay, depending on what you're doing, most cases, depending on what you're doing, you're not going to be taking the trigger assembly out. Normally you're just going to be taking the sear out. Again, I'm going to start with a sear and show you how to do the sear. I could start with the trigger assembly and take the trigger assembly out, and then I could do the sear, or vice versa. I can do the sear and do the trigger assembly. It doesn't matter. They'll each come out. What you need is something. You got to knock the pins out. Now there's 2 pins on here. This pin right here holds the sear assembly in, and then there are 2 pins. There are two pins. I'll flip the takedown lever up. There's 2 pins. There's another pin. These 2 pins are identical pins. That pin, and then there is the trigger pin in there. So there's 2 on the front that have to come out to remove the whole assembly, and there's only 1 on the back that remove the sear. We're going to take the sear out, so I'm just going, and I'm using this tape because you got to punch it out, so you got to have something so that you can knock the pin out and have it drop through. And I'm just taking a little punch with a small hammer here and just going to tap that on out of there. Okay, got a little bit left. There it is right there. There's the pin out right there. So I got the pin out. No pin in there. Okay, these are usually pressed in a little bit, and so what you're going to end up doing is I just take a little screwdriver in there and just kind of wedge it up. See how that's coming up out of there? Just go ahead and get it up. Once you get it up enough, you can usually grab a hold of it and pull it right on out of there. Okay, now pull the trigger, because what the trigger will do is it allows the trigger to move more up in the air. So as you're pulling this out, pull back on the trigger as you're starting to get up near the top there. Pull back on the trigger, and then you can just slide that out of there. There you go. Trigger, and you can see what I'm saying as I pull the trigger. See how the trigger bar pops up a little bit more? It's down, and as I pull it, it pops up. That gives you more clearance to get it out. You don't want to bend this. This little tail that comes off the bottom of the, and I'm going to squeeze in there a little bit closer and see if we can't get a picture on there. Yeah, a little clearer. That little tail on the bottom here. You don't want to bend any of this. You don't want to bend the little loop in there. The shepherd's loop, the sear loop, whatever you want to call it, and this little tail that comes out of there, you do not want to damage that. You'll mess a lot of things up. You obviously don't want to damage this. This is the striker safety. just be careful on all that stuff. You see this little piece of blue tape? It's because I've taken a measurement off there. That's why that's on there. That would not normally be on there. Okay, we have the sear assembly out. Very simple. I have the sear assembly in my hand here. Let me see if we can get focused in a little clearer here. Okay, there's the sear assembly complete in there. Okay, there's the safety on it. The safety is on there. And that's it. So we have taken the sear assembly out. Okay, now I'm just going to set that off to the side. And let me get something. Set it down here. I don't need a little bit of oil all over my towel I've got set up here. Okay, so we've got the sear assembly out. Now we're going to do the trigger assembly. Again, you can do either one. Doesn't matter which one you do. One you can do first, one you can do second. It doesn't matter. Okay, trigger assembly. This you need to put up in about the 10 o'clock position here. Okay, and let me get it up there. Get it up a little higher. And actually it doesn't have to be, because there's a little slot in there, and I'm going to try to get a little flashlight in here and try to get zoomed in here and make this as clear as I can and put some light in there. Okay. This is the hard part, is trying to get enough light in there and also get it to focus down in there. It's pretty clear. I just can't seem to get enough light down in there that you can see it. I can see it with my eye. But there is a little, right down in the corner there, there's like a little tiny notch. And that's where this comes out. And so you just got to wiggle it around, and I've got it up at that. See, it's coming out right now. I've got it up. What would that be? That would be about 10 o'clock. It'd be somewhere between 2 and 3 o'clock. I said 10 o'clock. And I'm just wiggling on that, and I'm pulling out on that. We're pulling out in the takedown pin, and it's coming out. You can see it's come out quite a ways right now. Just pulling out on that takedown pin, and then it comes out. Okay, and then again, you just keep turning it around until you find out where that other little notch part is on it. Just rotate it around, and there it is. It's out. And what I'm saying with a notch, I can show you now that I have this thing out of there. See that little notch there? Right there. I'm going to tip it around that way a little bit. It's a white background on there. You can see there's a little notch. Okay, that's the little notch that you got to get fit in. So when you look in here, and let's see where that little notch is. The little notch here on this one is right there. There's the little notch. I don't know how well it shows, but you can see it. And you can actually look through and you can see the same little notch in the background. That's what the takedown pin has got to fit into. So we've got the takedown pin out. Okay, now, it doesn't matter which one you do first. You can do one or the other. You've got these two remaining pins. I normally take the locking block pin out. So I'm just going to knock that pin out of there. Okay, got it out. Got the pin out. Okay. Now, it still won't come out because we have that's the trigger pin. And all you got to do is take a small punch, and it comes out from the opposite direction. That's a head on it. That's larger. So you just grab it from the other side, and you just go ahead and push that thing out of there. Once you got it out a little ways, you can grab a hold of it. Once it's out a little way, then you can just go ahead and pull it the rest of the way out. Okay, it's out. Now the trigger will come out. The locking block comes out, and the locking block is retaining the slide stop is in there. Set that down there, and then the trigger, you just gotta push it up and pull it on out of there. Now the trigger's out of there. Now we got the trigger out of there. Only thing I'm gonna show you, because this will happen, I guarantee you, the trigger spring is loose, because it actually, the trigger pin goes through there, and you can see the little loop at the end of the spring. Right there, the loop at the end of that spring right there. Well, the trigger pin goes through there and it holds it in place. Well, now that this is loose, this trigger is going to, the trigger pin is going to go all over the place. And let me just get in here as close as I can to see if I get focused down in here. Okay, I'm pretty well focused down there. And the opening on the spring is at the top. That's what you want it when you, if it should fall out, which it likely will fall out, if you look at it, you got the little hoop on the spring and it's open at the top. So when you put, when that spring goes, falls out, and it's probably going to fall out on you somewhere along the line, that's how you put it in. There's the hoop. You start, it doesn't matter where you start from, but when you get done, when that spring's in the right spot, and again, I'm going to put it back in. I got it out. Yeah, just dropped it. Put it back in. Okay. I can't get it in that little, I'm missing the little hole that's in there. It's right down at the bottom there. Okay. There's in the hole. It's going to go in like that. So the hoop is in the bottom. And then when you put the spring, it goes up like there. So the opening, when you've got it assembled properly, the opening and the hoop is at the top. It's not going down. It's not pointing down. It's pointing up. That's the only thing I want to explain. So we have it apart. We have the sear assembly. We have the sear assembly out. Okay. And we have the trigger assembly out. That's it. That's it for this segment. Got the gun taken apart. Okay, this segment is going to be how to get to the striker safety. As you can see, this is the slide for my Shield 40. Okay, and obviously we're going to take the barrel out of it. We don't need the barrel in it for what we're doing here. So we get the barrel slide. Now, the striker safety is right there, that little round shiny section there. There's two reasons to remove this striker safety. The two biggest reasons are you're going to modify the trigger. Like in my case, I'm going to put an Apex trigger kit in there, and the comes with a new striker safety, and it comes with a low pressure spring. And the other reason is grittiness. A lot of, you know, just before you get to the break point on some of the M&P models, including the Shield, you get that grittiness feeling. Okay, well, the way to test for the grittiness feeling is, the easiest way to test for the grittiness feeling to find out if it is coming from the striker safety, in my case it was coming from the striker safety, I've already diagnosed it, is I'm gonna get in here a little closer in here. Hold this on an angle where I think you can see it. Okay. Originally what I did is I took like a punch or something like that and I pushed straight in and out on the striker safety. And I wasn't feeling any grittiness. It was working nice and smooth. And I said, well, Jesus, there's nothing wrong with my striker safety. I'm not having a problem with the striker safety. But the problem was that I actually was pushing for the wrong direction. Because the trigger bar, and let me just show you the trigger bar where I have this thing in here. Here's the trigger bar right here. I've got the trigger bar right there. Okay, this is the part that contacts the striker safety right there. Well, it doesn't hit it. As you can see, the striker safety is actually hanging down. Let me get a punch that's about the right size of the striker safety. Okay, pretend this is the striker safety, and the striker safety is sitting there right about like that. Let me make sure we're focused on here. I don't want to give you a blurry picture. What's going on here? Okay, now we're focused. Okay, so when you're pulling the trigger, the striker safety is hanging down about like that, and then as this hits it, it starts pushing it up in the air. So the trigger bar moves back, catches the striker safety, and then it pushes it up in the air like that. The problem is when you're testing the striker safety, if you did like I did originally, I just pushed straight in and out, it didn't feel like there was a problem. Well, there was a problem, and I was actually pushing on it from the wrong direction. What you need to do is push on it from an angle. You need to push on it like that way from an angle. Okay, don't push straight up and down like this way. Okay, don't go straight in and out. Go at an angle like this and push it in and out. And then you'll feel the grittiness. Well, that's what happened with mine.
I took it apart. I didn't find any problems with it. I put it back together again, put the gun all back together, and again, I was getting the grittiest. Well, it's because the way the trigger bar and that little tab on the trigger bar hits it, it hits it on this angle and pushes it up from this angle. And that's why I wasn't getting any of the grittiness. Well, you're going to find the grittiness this way for sure if you have any grittiness. Okay, and then you have to remove that striker safety and clean out the bore for that striker safety. We're going to show you how to do this. And basically what it amounts to, it's pretty easy. The hard part is getting that rear sight off. You have to remove the rear sight, okay? Number one is there is a set screw in there and you got to loosen the set screw. Well, the set screw on most of the guns is red Loctited in. They use the red Loctite. Well, with red Loctite, the chances are if you put a Allen head wrench in there and try to unloosen it, you're not going to get it loose. And what's going to happen, you're going to probably end up twisting the Allen head wrench because it's such a small size before you get that loose. What you generally have to do is you have to heat that up. So you take your little propane torch and you put some heat on there and get that pretty hot, and then you take your Allen wrench in there, stick it in, turn it, and it should loosen up. That's what I had to do with mine. I did have to heat mine up to get it to come out. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take this out in my garage and we're going to knock that rear sight off of there. Okay, here we are out in my messy garage. I got all kinds of garbage and stuff like it up in here. I think you can see right up in there is my MIG welder I've got up in there. I've got a drill press in there. Back underneath there, you can't even see it. That's my air compressor. You can see the hoses running all over here. There's a little metal cutoff saw. My workbench that I've got here. Got my vise. There's my oxyacetylene tank setting up there, and underneath there is a little 300 amp arc welder. So I've got a few little toys. Used to have more, but cut back a little bit. Don't have quite near as much as I used to have. Okay, we're going to set the slide. I have the slide out here and I've removed the set screw, so the set screw is not in here. And what I've got is I've got a block of wood, and this is some cork gasket material. It's to protect the slide when I clamp it in here, so I'm not going to scratch up. This is obviously a metal vise, and I don't want to clamp down the middle vise on here and have it put marks on the slide. So let me get this thing straightened out here. Okay, put the slide. Now, what they recommend knocking this thing out from left to right, and so that's which way I'm going to do it. Let me see. Are we seeing? Yeah, you can see it right there. I'll see if I can get in here a little bit closer in here. Not that it's going to make a lot of difference. All you're going to do is see me pounding on this thing. Okay. I've got some tape over the punch that I'm going to use, but it isn't do much good. It's still going to put some marks on the punch. There it goes. It's starting to move right now. Yeah. It's also starting. I didn't have it in there tight enough, so I'm going to have to re-tighten it up again. I don't want to over-tighten it. It's really pressed in there really good, let me tell you. Okay, it's coming out now. And I'm going to get it so it's almost out. I don't want to knock it completely out. Whoops. I said almost out. One tap too many, I did knock it out. You got to keep your finger on there because there is something that will come falling out of there. I'm going to put it back in a little ways. Okay. Yeah, didn't have it all the way in there. I don't want to lose those parts there. So I want them to stay in there. Get that back down in there. Okay, well. Okay, I'm going to take it out. Take it back in there, make sure I don't lose any of the parts, and we'll be back in my office in a second. Okay, I'm back in. As you can see, there's the rear sight. There's the set screw. I have the set screw right there. I just dropped it. There's the set screw for the rear sight. So we've got that removed. What you've got left here is you've got this little plastic cover that covers the spring And I'm just going to ahead and pull that out of there as it's coming out. I'm getting the hole. That's the striker safety right there. And you got the little plastic cover on top of the spring. I'm going to pop that out of there. Okay, just pull that right off of there. And you got the spring, and there's the striker safety. Then you got the borehole here. And again, if you're having the grittiness, you have to clean that borehole out. Well, the problem with the borehole is, and I'm going to get some light in here, get in here as close as I can and get focused on there. Okay, we're clear. See the shininess in there? I got some light in there. You can see that shiny. That's actually the striker sticking in there. And it actually does stick in that bore. Okay, so you got to remove that the striker to clean the bore out. Okay, and I'm going to show you how to remove the striker. You just get underneath there. There's the striker right there moving there. Normally when it cocks it, it's going to cock it backwards that way. I'll use a punch so you can see. When it cocks it back that way. And then sear grabs a hold of it, and the sear releases it, and then it springs forward. And if you look out at this end, you can see the right down in here where the hole is. You can see there's the end of the striker, which would be piercing the primer and making the boom. Anyhow, we need to remove that. Well, how do you remove it? You got to take the end cap off of here. That end cap right there has got to come off. Okay, so you just take get yourself a small punch or something down inside of here, and get it inside where the springs are in there, and just push the striker towards the front. And when you grab a hold of it and get it up there and push it towards the front, then and I don't have it up far enough. Let me use a little bit bigger one here. Okay, there it goes. I got it up towards the front. And now I got to watch my hand because it'll going to pop out. I got to keep your hand in there. There's the end cap come off of there. Okay. And I'm just going to go ahead and push back on it. And there comes the striker completely out. Nice, nice clean looking striker, isn't it? Okay. We've got the striker out of there. Okay, now that you've got the striker out of there, the only thing that's left inside of there is the little plastic insert that's in there. And that's something you don't have to pull out. You could pull that out, but there's no reason to pull that out. Now, what I did to get the burr that was in there is I used a little Dremel grinding wheel like that. Okay, and I just stuck that little Dremel grinding wheel down in there and run it up and down in there a couple times all the way around. But the thing I will tell you is you can't use this with the Dremel motor. The Dremel motor is very high speed. Let me refocus again. We're getting back here. Okay, it's very high speed. If you put something in there that's almost the exact same size in there, this thing's going to spin around and chatter. This little thing will spin around and it'll bust. You're going to bust it. You're going to put gouges in the side of it. You need to have something low speed. So what I did is I put this in the end of a drill motor, clamped it in the drill motor, low speed, you know, like about 500 RPMs or something like that, and just run it down in there and run it back and forth, run it around the edges like that, run it around that way, run it in and out a few times, and I cleaned it out. And I got the burr, and what there was a machining burr down inside there. When they bored this hole out first, and then when they bored the hole for the striker, it left the burr inside of here. And I'm surprised they don't run reamers or something to clean this thing out, but they didn't. And it left, and again, like I told you, when I pushed down the angle on here, it tipped it forward and it was getting a burr that was right up in this front area, up in there is where I was getting the burr. Anyhow, by running the little Dremel wheel down in there, low speed, do not use, I'm telling you right now, I'm an ex-tool and die maker, I know. You can't put something in there that's just slightly smaller, because what will happen is it'll start catching and it'll just whip it all the way around, and it'll put little gouge marks all the way around, plus the fact it's going to bust this material off the wheel. So you have to use it something at very low speed. I originally tried to use a little small round file on there. This is because this slide is stainless steel. It's really tough material, and I couldn't get it to file. The file would not cut it. It wasn't strong enough. That's why I went to the Dremel wheel. Anyhow, for those of you that are having a problem with that grittiness feeling, and it's caused because of the striker blocker, that's how you take care of that. Then what you would do is you just make sure you clean it all out, get all that grit out of there, clean it real good. I would suggest compressed air or something like that to blow that all clean. Once you get it all clean, then you go ahead and reassemble and put your striker back in. Put the cap over the top of the striker. You slide the sight back on. The sight, of course, we took it off from left to right, so the sight will go on from right to left. And just line it up. And by the way, when you're taking the sight off, make sure you note where the sight is, because when they align the sights in the factory, it might be off center a little bit. It might be a little bit over this way. It might be up that way a little bit, or it might be down that way a little bit. You know, I'm exaggerating it, but make sure you know where it is. So when you put it back on, and again, I've got it upside down, but it doesn't matter. It's either going to go, it's going to be stuck in that way. And you can look between the edge of the sight and the edge of the frame and see how much space there is. And you try to get it back in the same spot. That way, when you go out and shoot it, it's going to be relatively accurate. Otherwise, if it was originally up on the high side and you end up putting it on the low side, well, then your target's going to be off by 3, 4, 5 inches, something like that. So take a look at it before you take it off so you know where to replace it. Anyhow, assuming that you have cleaned the bore hole out, everything runs nice and smooth, then you can go ahead and reassemble it, and that takes care of it. Okay? Okay, I missed a step. As you can see, I've already got the striker blocker installed, and I had to come back and take the actual striker. I forgot to show how to install a striker. Okay, so we'll assume that this is not installed. It doesn't matter whether that's installed or not. You can remove or install the striker either way. Okay, so we've got the gun clean. Everything's clean. Make sure you clean the, obviously we wanted to clean the bore where the striker safety was, but you also, if you had to do any grinding or filing, you want to make sure the bore hole for the striker itself is nice and clean. So we're going to get it nice and clean. I put a little bit of oil on the outside, of just a slight bit of oil. You don't want an oily striker. If you get too much oil, they say that the oil can give you misfires. So you don't want a lot of oil, but I do put a light coating of oil on the outside of the nylon there, just to make it. And again, I'm putting a little oil on my finger right here, just to put a little bit of oil on there. Around the outside there, around the side there, the front guide and the back guide. That's it. Okay. You slide the striker in, and there's only one way it can go in. Obviously, you got this larger part right here. And let me just make sure we're staying in focus here. Okay, it'd be focused. This has to go up vertical. So when you slide the striker in, you put that in like there, it goes vertical, and then you can't push it in. Now, in my case, because I have the striker safety in there, I can't push it in any further. The only way I can get it to push in further is I have to push down on the striker safety. So I push down, now it goes in, now it's past that, okay? And for me to get that to go in all the way, I have to push in on that striker safety more. Okay, now I've got it past the striker safety, so it's in. However, I still can't put this end cap on because the plastic is in the way in the back there. That plastic has to go in. And the only way you do that is, again, you stick a punch or something small that goes in there, and you get inside of the plastic in there. And let me just push this thing out a little bit more so I can get down inside of there. Okay. You have to... basically, let me pull this thing out and I'll show you right now. What you want to do is you want to get, you've got the actual, on the end of the striker, you got that vertical. Well, you need to get beyond the plastic. See how this plastic moves when I push it in with the spring right there? So what you need to do is you need to get inside of there. So you need to push in and get your punch or a little screwdriver or whatever using between the plastic and that little vertical from the striker. And then that way, once you're inside of there, and again, I'm going to try to hold it with one hand. Actually, I'm going to put it down here and put it down there. Now I've got that in the middle there. Now you can see I've got it between the plastic. Now I can push it in. That's the only way you can do it. So again, we're going to go ahead and make sure this is installed again, put it back in there. Okay, And because I've got the blocker in, it's actually easier to put this thing in without having that blocker in there, but I've got the blocker in there. And all I've got to do is get started so I can get inside that plastic. Now I'm inside the plastic, and I can push it over far enough. Got to push the block. I'm setting this down on the table so you can see what I'm doing here. Setting it down on the table so I can push that blocker in and pull that back in so I can get that in. And where did I put the cap? There it is. End cap goes on there. Get it started. Get pushing in there. There it goes. It just fell down in. Now I got the end cap on there. Got the striker on there. Now the ice striker will not go forward anymore. And the reason it won't go forward anymore, let me make sure I'm focused here, is because I do have that blocker installed. So if I push in on the blocker, now I can get the striker to move forward. Right now, that's a test you can do. Is if I with the blocker up, raised up, you should not be able to push this striker forward. You should not be able to push that forward. It should just stay there. And if you push in on the blocker, and I'm just going to take another little punch and push in on the blocker, now I can push that forward. Now you can see, I'm not pushing down on it. Now I'm pushing down on it. Now you can see it going forward. Now you see that moving forward like that? And also you can look at the, as we showed before, the little opening in the hole right there. If I'm pushing in on the blocker, we should be able to see... point it up there so you can see on the end there. Pushing in on the blocker, you can see the there's that pointer coming out at the end. That's the end of the striker coming out right down there. Okay, and I can push in and go in, but that's the safety factor. That will not move. You can't get this to move. The striker will not move forward because the blocker is up raised. That's it. So now we know how to get the blocker, the striker back in. I forgot to do this video, so I'm adding this video in. Okay, for those of you that are installing the Apex sear, we've got the sear housing removed from the shield. The first thing you got to do is take the safety lever out, because you have to remove the sear pin, and the safety lever is blocking the sear pin from moving. It's real easy. You just slide, I'm going to turn it around the opposite side, and you can see you just slide the end of it down. There's like a opening right up in here. Just slide get the end of it down in that opening and just tip it up. Just kind of wiggle it, and out it comes. See how easy it is? So now we've got the safety mechanism out of there. Okay, and what we want to do is, there's the sear pin right there. There's the end of the sear pin right there, that head right there. And we're going to go ahead and just push that out. There's not a lot of pressure on there, so it's real easy to take that out of there. Make sure we're still focused in here. Okay, and I'm just going to stick my pin in there and stick it in there. Now, I'm going to keep, when I take that out of there, I want to keep my finger over the top of the, and I want to keep this level, but I want to keep my finger over the top because there is a little spring pressure in there. We don't want that thing popping all over the place. We just go ahead and pop that out of there. Okay. And there it is. I've got the there's the sear pin out. Right in my hand here was the sear pin right there. And now I can just go ahead and pick the sear up out of there. Okay, and there's the sear out of there. So now we're left with just the housing. That's it. Okay, we've taken this sear. This is the stock sear out of the sear housing. We're just going to kind of show you the difference. I don't know how well it's going to show up here. I'll get as close as I can. You're dealing with the lighting conditions too. See how close I can focus. That looks pretty focused there. Okay. The biggest difference between these, and I'm going to get in here with that pointer again, is this one is much smaller, a little more rounded off in the front. This is the Apex sear, and this one here you can see is much longer. Okay, so that's much longer from there to there. And basically what they did is they cut the angle off and rounded this off a little more. Other than that, the two sears are pretty well the same except for one other thing, and this is the contact area. If you look at this sear here, you can see how it kind of
curves out right there. Instead of being flat, it kind of curves out there. And we're going to go to the apex here, and it doesn't do that. The apex here is pretty well straight up and down. It actually even flattens out a little bit right there. And what that does is it just reduces the amount of pull pressure. This one, the stock one, which is the shinier of the two, I'm going to set one on top of the other so you can see it. Okay, it sticks out more at the top, so it's going to cause more pressure. It's going to take more pressure, and the bottom one is pretty well flat, straight, you know. So that's the differences between the sears themselves. And now the difference between the striker blocker right there, and it's pretty hard to tell because there's so much light in here. But the biggest difference between the two is the fact that this is the stock sear, and it's really, it's kind of straight, and then it's got a flat on the side, then it's straight. Where this one is round all the way around, that's all radiused all the way around. And I know it's really hard to tell. I'm going to tip it up. I think you can see the flat on this one with the lighting. You get so much reflection. This one you can't tell because it's round all the way around, so you can't see an area on that. It's radiused all the way around on the side, all the way down. It's all radiused. Where this one here has just like a little flat on the side of it. And that's just to make a smoother engagement. A little, and that also reduces the trigger pull too by about a pound. So now we've got those back, and the other difference is the springs. I'm going to pan down here, let you see the springs on these things here. And there's the two springs. I'm going to set them as close as I can to each other, and you can see the difference in the length of them. Actually, I'll do them this way and this way. Get them as close together as I can. Okay, and there's, well, now they're actually touching, but you can see the difference. And let's see if we can focus on there. Okay, that's a little better there. The difference is the apex here is the shorter one. Okay, this is the apex here. It's shorter, probably by about a quarter of an inch. Well, because it's shorter, it's going to produce less pressure. So it's going to take less pressure to engage the, to push that, the blocker up. Okay, so now what we got to do is reassemble. We're gonna start with the sear housing, and we're just gonna put the new sear in. And basically what you're gonna do is just line it up in the position that it goes, push down on it, and I'm gonna oil it up a little bit, get some oil on there. Okay, we got that oiled up here. I'm going to set that down in there like it goes. Okay, we've got it oiled up. I'm going to set it down in there like it goes. Then I'm going to put a little more oil on the sear pin here. Okay, and then you just push down, because that is spring loaded. You need to push down to get that pin to go in there. There it is. So now I've got the new apex sear in there, and we'll just take a punch here and we'll push it. Make sure it goes up and down. You can see we've got the sear is in there, and as I push it, it goes up and down. That's the apex sear in there. Now the only other thing is, as far as the sear housing goes, there's nothing else I need to install on there. I just need to put the safety back on, because I want to keep the safety. Not everybody wants the safety, but I want the safety on there, so I'm just going to attach that little section that has the hook on it, or the little, when I say the hook on it, call that the little tab that goes in there. Just put that in on the one side, start it in on the other, okay, and then we're just going to line it up and stick it in there, and now we've got it in there. And it's best to have it in the down position. There's less pressure. If you put it in the up position, it puts more pressure. Keep it in the down position, get it lined up, and just make sure that you can get that punch in there. You got everything lined up properly. You can get that punch all the way through there. You can see I've got that punch all the way through there, and I've got my safety in there. Goes up, goes down. Everything works on there. Okay, so the only other option I got to do is reinstall that sear housing. Okay, now I'm back to the slide. We've got the slide here, and what do we have to do with the slide? Real simple. We just put to make sure we got the right radius. And again, I'm going to put a little oil on here. I want to make sure that that thing is going to move freely up and down inside that bore hole. I'm putting a little oil and dropping that in there. Okay, there it goes. I'm going to make sure I got that shorter spring in there. There's the shorter spring in there right there. Okay, then they got the little plastic cap that goes on here. Put that little plastic cap in place. This is going to be a tough one for me with my big hands. I've got big hands trying to put it on that little top of that spring there. Actually, believe it or not, I got it in there right there. Okay, and then we're going to put this. Then I'm going to go ahead and put the rear sight in. Okay, I've got the. Before I actually do anything, I'm going to make sure this thing rides up and down freely. So I'm going to take one of my little punches in here. I'm going to hold the spring from the other side and push. Yeah, there's no burrs, there's no nothing. Everything is riding up and down nice and smooth. I want to make sure before I go ahead and re-put that sight on there. And of course, that little cap just come off there. Let me see if I got it back on there. I think we got it back on there straight. I'm going to check real close for the... with a flashlight here to make sure I see I got it on there in the middle there. Yep, it's in there in the middle. Okay, next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to push down on that, and I'm going to start, again, we're going to reverse the way we put the sight on. Last time we put the sight on from left to right. Now we're going to put the rear sight on from right to left. Make sure I got that in there. That's in there good. Okay, that's as far as I can push it in now. I've got it in about that far. It will not go any further in. I'll have to take it outside and drive it in again, and that's what I'm going to do. So we've got that far in. We're going to go ahead and take it outside and drive it back in. I'm not going to show you that. I think we showed you how to take it out. It's pretty self-explanatory how to drive it right back in. Okay, depending how far you took the gun down, if you took the trigger assembly down and you took the sear assembly out, it wouldn't matter which one you start in first. But I'm going to assume that most people did not take the trigger assembly out, so I'm going to go ahead and put the trigger assembly back in. Okay. First thing is, my spring come out. I told you that's one of the things you got to remember, that there's a good chance that spring is going to come out. And remember which way it goes back in. Okay, I've got the spring in the right way. That's the way it goes. Okay. And we're going to go ahead and just drop that trigger down in there. Put that trigger set in there. Okay. Then the locking block goes over the top of it. Now it goes in at a kind of an angle. And how you can tell the angle is, let me focus up a little bit better here. If you look at the, again, it's going to be hard to see it. Let me get my pointer here and the groove. There's a groove right in here that goes that way. I'm going to try to get some more light in there. I think you can see that groove now. That groove kind of goes at an angle. So when you slide that in there, this locking block doesn't go straight down. The locking block, it kind of goes in and it kind of goes backwards. I mean, I'm exaggerating. It doesn't go that far backwards, but it goes in like that way. So we have the trigger down in there, and we're going to go ahead and slide this down over the top of it. And again, it just takes a little playing there. I got it down. So it's already in there. We got the locking block in there. The hardest part of the whole thing is putting the trigger spring back in. And the trigger spring, because don't forget that spring has to go through there. So what you've got to do is, as you're pushing the trigger spring in, and you've got to line the trigger up, got to get that trigger, the holes lined up for the trigger. So move the trigger around so you can see the holes, get those holes lined up, and then go ahead and get that trigger pin started in there. So it's partially in there. Okay, now the next step is, what I found is I get something on there, like with this little hook on there, and grab a hold of that top of that spring and just pull that spring up in and push the trigger pin back in. And that's what I'm trying to do right now. Matter of fact, I'm going to pull this out, put a little more oil on it, because it's not going in there nice and smoothly, and it should go in there smoothly. Put a little more oil. It's amazing how what a little bit of oil will do. Okay, again, getting it lined up, getting the holes lined up, putting the pin in there. I got the pin started in there now, and now all I got to do is pull that spring up, the round head of the spring up in there, and get it up in there high enough so that I can go ahead and push that trigger pin back in the rest of the way. There we go. And I don't have it all the way in there, I just need a little bit more. Yeah, I got it too tight. I gotta pull it out again, push it back up in there. Like I say, it's not that big a deal. It's not that hard to put in. It's just being stubborn for me right now. Okay. Well, I'll tell you what. I'm gonna take a small screwdriver from the other side and push it up in there. Okay, that's another option you can do, is you can get a small screwdriver, get that trigger bar pushed back up in there. I'm going in on the other end of it through the hole, through the opening, grab a hold of that spring and push it up in there. Okay. Now I've got it over there. There it's in. That was easier. Okay. So we've got that part in. Okay. Trigger bar is working properly, everything's working, the spring is working, you've got to test it to make sure everything's working, you've got to push down on the back a little bit, otherwise it'll drag, okay? That's good. Then the only other thing we've got to do is we've got to drive that pin in there. And I'm just going to line it up there, put it on my little piece of tape on there. Now, when you're tapping these things in, if you reach a point where you're pounding down on it and it just does not go anymore, don't keep pounding harder. Find out if it's not lined up properly. These are polymer frames, and there is such a thing as you could hit a spot on there, and sure enough, you could pound a little bit too hard, and you can break that polymer frame. So you don't want to overly whack these things in there. Yeah, I got too far in on this side. There we go. Okay, trigger assembly is in. We've got the trigger assembly, we've got all the pins in there, it's ready to go. Okay, now we're gonna put the sear in. And the one thing I will tell you about the sear is, we explained, is the opening right in here, getting some light in here, make sure I'm focused in here. The end of the trigger bar goes in this little opening right in there. There's a little opening in there. Well, it has a tendency to want to come out and wedge it over in here as you're putting it in. So you got to make sure you keep it in there. It's got to go in there, and you got to make sure the safety is off. The safety's got to be in that down position. Otherwise, you will not be able to get this thing back together again. And what you're going to end up doing is you just make sure you pull up on the push the trigger in. So you want to be holding the trigger in so this trigger bar comes up as high as possible. And then you just get it started, get it down underneath there. Okay. And get it lined up in there, and then make sure, this is the part, like I said, you got to keep sure, make sure that you keep that trigger bar over there that goes in that hole. Once you get it in that hole, then you can go ahead and push this thing down. And I'm just making sure that I've got it in the hole. Get it lined up a little bit better. And you just got to wiggle with it a little bit. It's a little cumbersome, but it will go in there. I've got to get it forward a little bit more. Okay, make sure that I've got the trigger bar over. And from there, it should be just about ready to go down in there. I'm making sure I don't have any binding on there. That's good. Just too far up. Yeah. There it is. It's down in. Okay, I'm making sure everything works. I've got it in there. I'm making sure, you can see as I'm pulling it back, you can see the sear itself moving backward and forward. got it all in there. And then the other thing I'll make sure is, I'll make sure that that hole is lined up in there. Okay, the hole is all lined up in there. Safety's in there. We just got to go ahead and get our pin. Right, there's the pin, and I'm going to drive that pin back in there. And again, like I state, is just don't keep whacking on it if it ain't going in. As long as it's going down in there, you're fine. But if you reach a point where it's like it's not going in anymore, don't keep hitting on it. And I do, I'd rather hit it with light blows than real heavy blows. Don't want to hit it real hard. Bunch of little light blows. That's good. Okay, we have it back together again. Everything's assembled on there. We can go ahead and put our slide on. We can make sure we got a functioning gun here. One minor thing. It won't lock. You don't put the locking pin back in. Okay? I did forget about the locking pin. As soon as I slid it in, I said, whoops, we got a problem here. Again, we know that that little opening is at the top there, so just kind of wiggle it up the top. Keep that at about that 2 o'clock, 2:30 position. Just keep wiggling it in at that position until you get that thing to lock in. There it is right there. I got it in. Put it straight up and down. Now we can go ahead and finish putting this thing together. Got it locked. Unlock it. There it is. Got it back together again. Let me pan back a little bit now. Get a little more room here. Get some of this out of the way here. Got a gun back together again. Of course, we've got the Apex. All I put in was an Apex sear and an Apex blocker. And I'm going to go ahead and fire it. We know there's nothing in there. That's it. So we know it's working. All the parts are back together again. Okay. That's the assembly on it. And that's it.